Welcome back everyone to the lecture about applied bioimage analysis. This part will be about ImageJ macro functions, arrays, plots and tables. So let's start with functions. You have seen a couple of functions already. For example, when you call the open command, which opens an image for you, this is a function which is executed. But you can also make your own functions, custom functions, kind of, by defining with the function statement and again such a block with curly brackets. This is, by the way, the third place I mentioned earlier, where you are not allowed to put a semicolon actually. And you can define functions like that. So a function has a name, in this case it's the sum, it has some parameters. Then you do something with the parameters. For example, I calculate the sum with these two parameters and I return the sum. So not every function has to have a return statement, but it's actually quite practical in order to do certain complicated things. In a function somewhere down in the code, right, so I'm just hiding it, I don't care too much about the details, I know that my sum function does the right thing, I tested it in very detail, and then my actual code becomes simpler because I just call the sum function which does the job and I don't have to care for details. So let me just show you what it does. Yeah, so it outputs 8 obviously. It is also, I mean, for mathematical stuff it's kind of obvious that you can, for example, do things like that. But what you can also do is you can, for example, define a function for particular purposes, like doing the following. Get mean intensity of image. And then you call the getStatistics command. That's a different function. And it delivers, among other parameters, it delivers the mean. And then you can return the mean value. You can in functions also apply a threshold, apply a Gaussian blur, count the number of objects, and then return the number of objects. So this is what makes functions so practical, right? So yeah, and therefore I need an image. And if I execute this program, it again outputs the number 8 because it's still calculating the sum for me, and afterwards it outputs the mean intensity because it calls the getMeanIntensity method. So this is a method call and this is a method definition. Then inside it does some complicated things and returns the mean intensity. This is basically this is how it works. When the program reaches this particular line, it jumps from here, executes the block behind the function definition, and as soon as it hits one of the return commands, it will return this number. This number will go in this variable, and then I can print it out. That also means if I, for example, put a print statement here, this will not get executed, because it's after the return statement. Return basically ends the function. So just a little recap from last week. A variable is a piece of memory, kind of, in the computer, which can hold certain values. For example, if I program something like this, measurement equals 5, then we have in the computer memory somewhere a little block which has the name measurement and contains the value 5. If I call name equals Drosophila, then there's a memory block somewhere in the computer where it's the name Drosophila is stored. And if I add two variables, also if they have different types, a number or a string, and then they will be combined in some way in this particular case. A new string comes out and it's then also saved in a memory block in the computer. So this is just a recap from last week. What are variables? And then there's a new thing I would like to introduce today. It's so-called arrays. Also, an array is also a variable, but it contains multiple entries. And these multiple entries, for example, are usually when you make a new array with 5 elements, this is what this line does, and you can print out arrays with array.print, so that's different from printing other variables. You have then in the computer, you have then these kind of 5 elements, which are 0 each. If you want to access one of these elements, you have to write this kind of bracket with an index behind saying which element of the array you would like to access. Computer scientists usually do it like that. You count, you start counting from zero. So the first element on the left in this array is element number zero, or element with index zero. And then this one is number one, two, three, four. So if the size of the array is five, then all numbers below five are valid for accessing these array elements. And you can, for example, change values in an array by just using it like that. Furthermore, if you want to access the array element in the middle, you can do it like this. And you can also combine numeric values and string values in one array in ImageJMacro. That's easily possible. And just as a proof, to execute this little program, you have it in the folder where also the slides are, and it will indeed print out the lines as I was drawing them here. There is a little pitfall related to arrays in ImageJMacro, or in many programming languages, actually, whenever you come to the point where some things are assigned by value and by reference. So that's the difference I will show you here. If you have a variable a and you set it to zero and you print it out, obviously the printout will be zero. If you then say variable b equals a, the value of a is copied over to b. If you afterwards change b, the value of b is overwritten, but the value of a is untouched. So if you print a again, it's still zero. Yeah, so that's kind of intuitive, and that's the normal way of accessing variables. With arrays, it is unfortunately a little bit different. Let's do the same strategy we do now with array and bury. So we have an array. We introduce a new array with five elements. These five elements are all zero per definition. This is how an array is initialized. And if we print out that array, we read these five zeros. Afterwards, I say bury equals array, and then I change bury. I change the element a little bit to the right, to the center, and I put a text in here. And afterwards, I print out array. I do not print out bury. And it's changed. This is by reference. So I can actually hand over an array somewhere, and this somewhere modifies my array. This is practical in some cases, but if you're not aware of that, it's confusing. That's why I'm mentioning here. If you want to study that a bit more in detail, try it out. Furthermore, you can initialize arrays, as you have just seen, it by handing over a single number, and then all elements will be initialized by zero. But you can also enter several numbers, and then a new array will be made with these three numbers in there. So this will create an array with three elements with these three numbers. And you can also create an array by handing over strings, and then these three strings will be put into the array. Furthermore, you can concatenate arrays also of mixed types. And yeah, last but not least, you can find out what other options are there for dealing with arrays. For example, the array copy method is quite practical if you want to avoid this by reference thing here I just explained. Arrays are actually quite necessary in order to do plots. So we have here two arrays, both have five elements, and these two arrays, I put now numbers into the x values and into the y values. And afterwards, with the plot method, I can plot them. I would not recommend doing plotting in ImageJ for a scientific publication or for like beautiful plots, because it's quite hard to get very conveniently looking plot out. But for quick plots, for example, if you just want to analyze a dataset and quickly have a look on a distribution of roundish cells over time or something like that, it's a quite easy and convenient way for getting a quick plot out. I'm just saying, if you want to change the visualization of this plot to really fit your needs, you will struggle in ImageJMacro because the possibilities here are limited. Better go for a different visualization or actually statistics tool like R, Python, Excel, whatever. And that brings us to tables. So you have seen tables actually already a lot in ImageJ. Whenever you do a measurement, it results in such a window with numbers, and you can read size, write size, and I will show you how to do this programmatically, and you can save it to disk. There are two ways for creating results tables. You have done both, I assume. So the first one is running the particle analyzer and checking the checkbox for display results. And this is how the ImageShare macro, the corresponding ImageShare macro code for this looks like. Furthermore, you can also, from the ROI manager, click on measure and create a results table like that. It basically should result in the same results table. And if you want to change the columns which are in this results table made by the measurement, either the particle analyzer or the ROI manager, you call the setMeasurements method, and you can also look at the recorder and what it records in order to, for example, measure the area. And we have done that last week already, right? So if you now want to, for example, read out the table line by line and do a calculation of your own particular shape descriptor, for example, you can do it like that. There is a macro, there is the so-called getResult method, where you hand over the column you would like to read and the line number. And like with arrays, also the line numbers start with zero. The last line, or the, actually the number of lines in your table, you can read out by calling the nResults method. And if you want to access the last line of your table, it's nResults minus one. Because again, if you have five rows, these five rows are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, not 5. And the program will crash if you ask for line number 5 in this particular case. By the way, you also find this on the cheat sheet. You can also manipulate, and I'm really using the term manipulation here because it's a bit dangerous. You can also manipulate tables by saying set result, which column, which row number, again starting at 0, the number or the string you would like to put into this particular element. Just saying here, handle that with care, because you can screw up your measurements. But if you, for example, want to add an additional column to make another calculated value out of your measurements, that's the way to go. That's the method to use here. Last but not least, sometimes you come to a point where you actually want to have two tables. And there are different ways of doing that, and I find this one actually quite practical. So for example, you read out with the particle analyzer, you read out measurements to the results table, then you do some calculations and you want to save the results of your calculations into a new table. If you don't need this new table on screen in ImageJ, if you just want to save it to disk, you can, for example, use this little code snippet, which defines a file name, which defines a headline of a new table, where the elements of the table, the columns, are separated with a comma, and you just write that to a file. And then with a for loop, which can look, however, go from any number to any number, you write additional lines into this file. So for example, numbers and the numbers squared. So if you come to the point where you have this results table on screen and you would like to get some numbers out and write them to a different table on disk, this is the way to go. All right, let's play a bit with tables, RIs, the RI manager, and basically all the important things together. I recorded a little program, so this is our starting point now. If I execute this program, it will open an image, it will do some thresholding. Also, it calls the particle analyzer to do a differentiation of all the objects, does some measurement, puts it in a table, and it adds the ROIs to the ROI manager. So this is kind of our starting point, and this is something you did earlier. What we have to deal with now, if you want to extend this program, if you want to add something by the end, one of the first potentially confusing issues we will have is if we execute this program again and again, and again, our results table becomes longer, and we also get more and more ROIs in the ROI manager. And that's a bit an issue because the more we try, the more tries we need in order to get our program running, it will be more and more confusing because there are more and more ROIs. So what we have to do first, we have to clean up at the very beginning. Therefore, again, we have a look in the macro recorder. If I click on, for example, let's assume there is an ROI selected in our ROI manager. So we see there's a command for this. And if we click now on delete, it will only delete this one. And if we want to delete all of them in one shot, we have to click deselect first and then delete. this is how you empty the RI manager. So I will just copy these two lines and delete the other ones before. And this is one of the steps we do before our program actually starts. So before the program starts, before we make new ROIs and send them to the ROI manager, we clean up the ROI manager. And furthermore, we only do this if there are already entries in the ROI manager. So we don't do this if the ROI manager is empty, right? Furthermore, there's a command for closing all images, which is called close all. So you can also see this one. And furthermore, if you want to empty the results table, there's also a command for this. No, we don't want this thing. Yeah. And if we execute this program now, we see we have these 64 entries here in our results table. We also have 64 entries here in the ROI manager. And if I execute the program again, it will still be the same. So the starting point is again and again the same. That's super important for reproducibility, right? Then we have our actual program, which does the segmentation and applies a threshold. And by the end, we want to concentrate now on the next step. So we keep this part of the program a bit out of the field of view, and we want to visualize all these ROIs in different colors. As you can see, they are already visualized, and that's why the first thing we do, let's clean up the macro recorder from time to time. We first of all untick this checkbox, and you see the command for this is show none. So we first want to visualize nothing to get started. And you see, I only write something like one line of code and I try it out. I write another line of code and I try it out. It's you go in small steps in order to achieve something quickly. If you write a long program and then you execute it for the first time, you will sit there for 3 hours to make it run. But if you only go in small steps, it's the better way. From my personal point of view, it's the better way of approaching a goal. So what do we want to do? We want to visualize an ROI in the ROI manager depending on properties in the table. So let's first of all select an ROI in the ROI manager. So there must be a ROI manager command for this. So when we go through these different commands you can do with the ROI manager, there is a select command. Yeah. And here I have to enter a number. So for example, I want to select the third item in the list and I want to set it to a particular color. So I just start entering color here and I go through these different commands and you find there's ROI get stroke color and there's ROI set stroke color. And we want to set the color to green, for example. Let's see what it does. Yeah, so we see now this particular ROI is now green. And if you want to go through all ROIs in the ROI manager, we program again a for loop, which goes from 0 to the number of ROIs. And instead of 3, we now select the ith ROI. Furthermore, I introduced here a variable, and this variable has no value yet. And this is supposed to be the ROI manager count. So it also here tells us the number of ROIs in the ROI. So let's see. Yeah, I only see one ROI selected, the one here on the bottom. What did I forget? In order to visualize all ROIs or several ROIs subsequently, I have to add them to the overlay. I have to add the selection to the overlay. And with that, I have them all and they are all green. And always try again if your program is still working after you change something. If we now want to make a decision of how the color is supposed to be, dependent on a certain measurement, for example, if we want to set the color according to the area, we first of all have to get the area somehow. So I make a variable area, and that's the commands for working with tables, get result. And here you enter a column. So I now enter the name of this particular column, it's area. And the row is also I, so like the ith ri, it's also the ith line in the table. And then I have in my area variable, I have a number corresponding to this number in this table. I can also print that out to quickly check if it's really doing what I'm thinking it's doing. Yeah, so it now prints out all these numbers, starting at 433, and it's indeed the first number. So this is how you check from time to time if the variable really contains the value you are expecting in there. You see again, it's becoming many, many windows on the screen, and it's normal, it's okay. In order to make color dependent on a measurement like area, we have to write an if statement with a condition, and the area, for example, should be larger or smaller a certain value. We can again go through the table and have a look. Okay, the values are between 100 and 500, and that's why we can here write something like 250. And if the area is larger than 250, we make it green, and otherwise we make it magenta. Yeah, and here you see now, dependent on the area, we see the RI in different colors. So maybe that's for now. The next part will be about user interfaces. See you soon.